go back into regular session. This is the June 1st meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. We had just left an executive session. We came to order at 6:30. We will move on first to announcements. Does council have any announcements?
Yeah, I wanted to, I'm wearing my batik tie that Rati and Nadia gave me. And yeah, and I just wanted to recognize how wonderful it was to have them in the village and thank the community, our village team, council, for making them so welcome and really underscoring that we are a welcoming community. I mean, I saw one thing that Rati put on Facebook about how people were greeting her downtown in their native language, and it was just so nice. And if you missed the May 28th community presentation, that was filmed, and I believe we'll be showing it on Channel 5 and hopefully have it online on our YouTube channel as well. So, and it's in our packet also. So a lot of great recommendations that I hope we'll be looking at soon related to social media for the village and our upcoming website.
Any other announcements?
Spring fair is coming up.
Spring fair is coming up June 13th. I don't know if we need to announce it, but it is. So well, let's move on to the consent agenda. Is it okay if we just kind of wait and to see if folks, family gets here? I mean, Dave's going to be here, I think, so.
Yeah,
let's go ahead and do the consent agenda. We have the minutes of May 4th. Special council meeting, minutes of May 18th, regular council meeting, minutes of May 18th, 2015, work session. The May 4th is not, that was a regular council meeting, wasn't it?
It should have been.
Yeah.
Yeah, I reversed, I wrote them in wrong here, although yes. I believe they're correct.
They're correct on the minutes.
Which.
And then also financials for April 2015. I believe that there were some minor revisions made that were shared with council members. Is that
on the minutes? Yeah.
Yes.
On the minutes? The
council members shared corrections.
Right.
To how does that work? Because I read them and I had a correction, so I sent it in to Judy. I guess
we should ask. Probably the only substantive. I don't know what your correction was. I made what might be considered a substantive change. That would have been to the May 18th minutes related to Judy's contract, the discussion around Judy's contract. So maybe we should pull that one out. What?
Mine was for it had to do with the vote on the utilities. Was that at the
what, you know what?
That was
the rate. So yes. So let's pull that one out. Let's pull out the minutes of May 18th from the consent agenda of the regular council meeting.
But we might want to get that process down. Like, is this the best?
Are we doing okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So. The consent agenda then will be the minutes of the May 4th regular meeting, May 18th work session, and the financials for April of 2015. A motion for approval?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor, excuse me, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, now we will separately review the minutes of the May 18th regular council meeting.
Do you want me to just throw in what the two sort of significant changes were?
Yes.
Does this say special?
The agenda is backwards, I think, yeah. But the minutes are correct.
Minutes are correct. This was a special meeting.
This was a special, yes.
Okay. I added at Karen's suggestion that she thought I was utterly fabulous and
no, why didn't she read?
She didn't want
what page? Wait, let's just hold on. Let's do page one since we're gonna review it. Let's do the any comments on page one? Page two. Oh wait, is it page one? Is that where this?
No, page two is your
page two.
Okay, page two. So that would be in the second resolution 2015-18, Judy, would you read the new language?
And I would have it verbatim, except that Sean broke his thumb, but what I have added is that, that Winter stated that the clerk had done an exemplary job and the council is pleased to offer a merit increase.
And I believe there was also language about, let me see if I can find it. There was also information, something about the fact that we had missed.
Oh, that, yeah, that council had been late in amending the contract and had implemented procedures to assure.
Okay, here, I'll read that, I've got it right here.
Yeah.
Wintrow commented that the clerk's contract was overdue and stated that a process is now in place to assure that clerk and manager contract evaluations are implemented annually, even in the event of change in council makeup. She commented further that the clerk's work had been exemplary and that council was pleased to offer a merit-based salary increase. Wintrow called the vote and the motion passed 5-0 on a voice vote. So those are, that's what's being added to the minutes. Any comments on that? Is that okay with everyone? Okay. Anything else on page 2? Did you have the mark?
Yeah.
Okay. Then page 3?
Yeah, so page 3, there's various bullet points there near the top of the page. And the new change will have them read as follows. The first two bullet points are unchanged. The third one reads, renters must provide a lease to the village. Landlord must provide leases to renters. The village should collect hire deposits as permitted by law. And then ASCO defines that renters should pay a deposit that is larger than currently collected so that it's closer to an average of 2 months of residential and commercial service.
Maybe you could send that
well,
to.
Well, no, she sent me that.
Oh.
Now I'm reading it. Actually, I would just like to not have the whole ask window time question, Judy, because I just said, what I said was that while I had originally thought that, I had heard back from other people that there are strict limitations on what we can do, so I was kind of muddled, basically, but I was saying that I thought we should try to collect a higher deposit as allowed by law.
Okay.
That's, I think, that's all I said, I believe.
Page 4 and page 5. Can I get a motion to approve as amended?
So approved.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So that went well, our first time pulling something off of the agenda. So, did you hear from?
They're on their way.
Okay. So then we'll move on to petitions and communications.
There were no individual petitions or communications from community members. There was a note from the MBRPC about the website. There's the monthly update from the library and a note about the skate park that's open. I think it's sometimes helpful to pull out things from the manager's report. And particularly what Patty said about water and the potential for groundwater while there's still some people here. The flushing on June 3rd, isn't that?
That we will not be doing the flushing until after the completion is done. So we don't really have a date for the flushing yet.
There's something else. There was something else I thought was. I know, the other thing. Was a lot of people think you're on hyper reach, but you're not. And there could be a variety of reasons why you're not. So if you didn't get a message about the boil alert, especially if you live on the south side of town, did that go to the whole?
No, it was only limited to the south side of town, south of Marshall Street.
Right, and so, the whole Antioch campus.
Well, Antioch notified themselves.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, we notified Antioch and they took care of the campus.
Yeah.
And there was a little bit of miscommunication about the Antioch school, but we've got that worked out.
Okay, so if you live in that area and you didn't get a notice, then you might want to, it's called a police, am I
Yes, the police dispatch.
Actually, I read that and I did that, and they, the police dispatch said, go to the village website.
You can, yes.
And at the bottom of the village website on the left, there's this little red thing that says alert something, and you punch it, and you can put in your phone number and how you want it to.
You can do it that way as well.
That's what the police told me.
So if you call into the police, they're just going to tell you to go to the website.
But I'm assuming that there is an option if people don't have computers, that they will take the information.
Yes, absolutely.
Were you asked if you had a computer?
No, but I guess I would have said if I didn't.
I can't do that.
Yeah, okay. Okay, I wasn't asked.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's it.
Okay, well, let's just go ahead and move into public hearings and legislation. I think both of those will actually go pretty quickly. So first, we've got the second reading and public hearing of Ordinance 2015-10. We can read that by title only and then have our finance director do some explanation.
Okay, this is the 2015 Supplemental Appropriations and Declaring an Emergency for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Oh, can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Melissa?
So this was just rather routine for a few expenditures that council was already aware of for the most part. I had given a supplemental sheet to the supplemental appropriation that just outlined everything that I was doing. There were a few shifts in the cable channel. There were some additional planning costs that were not originally appropriated. HRC had an addition of a Miller Fellow, and I knew that their bottom line budget was supposed to be $8,500. There was $3,300 that was personnel services that wasn't included, so I was fixing that now, but that was something that I originally caught once it was too late for the original budget. Street maintenance and repair covers the cost of the art can project. Those were funds that were raised through the community, but we still have to appropriate those funds in order to expend them, even though they were all brought in via donation. So that is a zero net expense for the village. The Bryan Center had a boiler go down in the building, so that was an emergency repair to the tune of $11,500. And then the federal forfeited assets in the state law enforcement trust fund, those were originally fund 215, and those were split off to split out federal and state. So there's a reduction in the fund 215, which is now labeled federal forfeited assets. And there was an increase in appropriations in the state law enforcement trust fund because the majority of money that was in that one pot was state money and not federal money. So I split those off appropriately, so that now we're in compliance, so that's a good thing. Parks and Rec Improvement Fund, those are for skate park inspections for $5,000. And then the electric fund is to cover the total additional appropriations for the new remote meters, where the village is gonna put in an extra $50,000 and then appropriating the $40,000 grant that we got as well. So it was all very routine things that council already knew about for the most part, so. That's that.
And I think we said it last time, but I'll just mention it again, we're also reimbursed for Miller Fellow costs.
Yes, all the Miller Fellow costs are reimbursable. We just have to still appropriate them even though they're brought in, so. Yes.
Any other comments or questions from council? This is the second reading and public hearing, so I will open it up for citizen comments. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Sam.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Astor.
Yes.
House.
Yes.
Winthrop.
Yes. Okay, our special guests have arrived for our other special guest. So, this is a very exciting and I feel very honored to be able to introduce this. We have an officer who is receiving a special commendation. I will turn the floor over to Chief Hale to describe the situation and to present an award.
Chief, could you turn on the mic?
Not within your job description.
bury the on switch.
For those of you who may not have heard, on Friday, May 1st, 2015, about 11 o'clock, we received a 911 call to West North College. We had an elderly resident at that location who had gotten up, stumbled into a pond. His daughter, in her 60s, had actually grabbed a phone, called 911, and had to go in the pond and struggle with her father to try to keep him afloat. Officer Meister was the first officer to arrive prior to the medics. When he gets there, he is able to go into the pond and get the elderly man out, during which time the female resident was nearly exhausted and needed help out of the pond also. Both of those subjects were removed onto the hospital. Officer Meister did pretty much went into the pond without concern for himself, and we were very, very proud of that. The Yellow Springs Police Department issues what we term an exceptional service award, that being one red ribbon. It'll be worn above the nameplate on his uniform at his choosing or at official ceremonies. The ribbon signifies outstanding service, such as intelligent performance or a highly credible, unusual law enforcement accomplishment. Sir Meister, if you can step up.
There we go.
They're actually both smiling. So that's a plus.
In addition, Pat, if you want to stay, in addition to that, council has issued their a commendation framed up here, exceptional service in the line of duty, signed by all council members. And we want to that for a quick second.
Thank you very much. Much appreciated. I appreciate the recognition. And I just want to recognize that we have a great department here. And we have a wonderful fire department that was just a few minutes after I arrived. They arrived on scene, so I was very thankful for that. Thank you very much.
And welcome to your family. Welcome to your beautiful family. Thanks for bringing the kids out. Thanks for being here, kids. Wasn't that cool? Okay, now we're moving on to Resolution 2015-19. You can read by title. Well, let's read this one because it's very short and it's... Go ahead and read it.
Okay. This is authorizing deduction for redistribution of the cost for the subpoena program. Whereas the village engages in circulating services of the Regional Income Tax Authority, RITA, the collection of local income tax, and whereas in the process of collection it is sometimes necessary for RITA agents to issue a subpoena to residents to address matters related to income tax collection, and whereas the cost of the aforesaid subpoena program is $8 per subpoena, now therefore the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that. Section 1. The Finance Director is hereby authorized to deduct from the monthly distribution check for RITA the amount expended for the subpoena program. Section 2. This authorization will continue in full force following its passage until specifically rescinded in writing by Council for the Village of Yellow Springs.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Melissa, could you explain this, please?
Every year, RITA, who is the Regional Income Tax Agency, sends us a letter. And they ask for direction in terms of how to deal with anyone who did not file their income taxes for the previous year. And we have three selections. We can either do nothing, or we could send a letter, or we could send letters and subpoenas. And last year, what we did was we just sent letters, which caused a lot of confusion because people got the letters, they didn't have anybody to talk to about it, and it just caused, I think, a little more confusion than what everybody would have liked. So The option that we were choosing to go with is called the subpoena program, which basically means that they'll send a letter saying that our records indicate that you haven't filed, and they'll actually have somebody from Rita that comes here and sits for a day or two and is able to talk to residents and help walk them through the process of filing if they have not. So it just kind of clears up any of those questions or confusions that residents may get from getting a letter. They have somebody face-to-face to sit down and talk to. There is a cost of $8 per letter for Rita to come out and spend that time. And I did ask them how many we were talking about, and they said that there were 1,388 delinquent accounts. So I think that they come out within the next 2 months or so. So that number could go down a little bit, but it is, I think, substantial enough for us to at least make the attempt and have Rita come out and be able to answer any questions that residents may have. So
that would be $8,000.
And they did not give me a dollar amount of what was delinquent, because those were just the number of people that have not filed.
But there probably is a minimum amount for even being considered delinquent.
Well, no, because for instance, my child was considered delinquent, but they had moved away, and all it is that you didn't file. And,
correct.
And so there was nothing owed. Some number of those letters, and it may be a significant number, are really of people who don't owe anything.
And they're just, right, my son got one of those too.
And, oh, yeah, so they often come, I think, when college students have filed, and then they aren't living at home anymore, and so they don't have to file because they're not living there.
So there is no way for us to find out if these letters are going out simply for filing or because there are, I guess they won't know. If somebody hasn't filed,
No. They
don't know if they're delinquent taxes.
No. So, I mean, we do have a choice. I mean, we can either send the letters again, but I think that everybody probably remembers last year it was kind of a debacle because, you know, we wanted Rita out here after the fact. We didn't do it ahead of time. We couldn't get somebody out here. So this is the only way to get somebody out here is to pay up front. So we had to have to let them know by June 15th whether or not we're going to do it.
So, I mean, okay, so can we pay them to come here for a couple of days without going through this? Pay them maybe $1,000 for a couple of days just for their time?
I can ask.
But I think the problem is if we don't pass this tonight, then we cannot take part in the program. As far as
this program, I mean, we could just move forward with just doing letters,
right.
And then I could ask them if we could get somebody that comes out here after the letters are sent, but they might say that that's the subpoena program and you need to pay for that. But I could always ask, and if they...
But again, I mean, we're not going to get 1,000 people to come anyway, you know, it's... If there are 1,000 letters sent out, the fact that the idea that 1,000 people are going to come to the village offices to meet with them is, it won't happen. I mean, and I know that we were concerned. I know there were questions about the letters last year. I know that it's one of these social media discussions that people were confused, but this...
this just seems a really high cost for what service they would be offering in return for it.
It's actually over 10,000, if we're talking about 1388. So is there a way to be selective? I mean, we can't really figure out, I don't know, parse them out somehow.
Can we get the list? And I mean, you can knock off the people that we know aren't here.
I think that would be pretty hard.
Yeah.
I mean, again, we really, unfortunately, aren't going to know. If they haven't filed, we don't know. I mean, it's a real catch-22.
Right. We don't know that they're not living here. We just
right.
know they haven't filed.
And I know that we've done this before in the past, so I don't know if a good practice might be to do every other year and, you know, or every 3 years or something. Just pay it for them to come out, maybe clean up some of this. I'm not sure. I'm not sure what the best answer to that is.
Do you think that's a possibility? I mean, where you would send it out
think you have the option every year of
participating. Yeah, they send the same thing every single year. And last year, I had talked with Kent, because that was when Kent Bristol was still here, and he said, just do the letters. But I know that we have done the subpoena program in the past. And I don't know if Rita will only, and kind of thinking about this now out loud, if Rita would only charge us for people that they had to meet with, but I mean, it seems like it's just, it's per subpoena, so whether they meet with them or not.
Chris, would you think that it's possible that just the legal nature of the subpoena, that's what we're paying for, right? Because the subpoena is a legal document.
Yes, I would tend to agree with that, and I question whether or not we'd have to, as you implied, a subpoena in every instance.
I mean, but people, I wouldn't be surprised just because people are required to file. I mean, if whether you owe or not, you're required to file. If you know, if they've got you on your records, I mean, they should probably, people should probably be, I don't know what to say. Because
Rita's not going to know if they moved away,
right,
or if they just didn't file.
So there's got to be some kind of a response. I don't remember ever agreeing
that out.
Right. I don't know. I don't remember ever this ever being an option. Well, I mean, that doesn't mean that we didn't at some point.
Never have looked into it.
There's actually an authorization letter that comes with it. There was one page where you have to fill out what your selection is out of the three choices, and then attach that as an authorization letter. And it actually says that it has to be by ordinance or resolution, and it has to have the number there, and or by motion with a copy of the minutes from council in order to move forward.
So we're going to have to, basically, we're going to have to decide, change this resolution potentially to take that option out. Do you have?
Well,
or do you
if we just do the letters, I don't think that we don't have to have a resolution or a motion by council.
So it's just for the subpoena.
It's just for the subpoena.
Right.
Yes, because there's money involved. There's no money involved if we just send the letters.
Well, I'm kind of tempted to just go with the letters. I know it's confusing people, but it gets them to call down the village and say, kid moved away. What am I supposed to do?
I know that in my office we didn't get a tremendous number of calls, so it really wasn't, weren't put out.
I don't sense that it's worth $8,000.
Right.
For maybe 2 days of Rita's, somebody from Rita's time to sit there and have maybe nobody show up. So.
But going the next step though, related to actual unpaid taxes, is somebody working on our behalf to get those collected?
I think that they just want direction from us on how to proceed, because it's going to take
so
more of their time.
So if we don't subpoena these people,
they're not going to
pursue collection?
I mean, we have to tell them whether we want them to do nothing, send a letter, or subpoena.
I know, but so they send a letter, and what if somebody doesn't respond? I mean, they've got to be doing something. I mean, it can't be just one contact and then that's it.
Would there be a way for them to tell us, if we choose to not do the subpoenas this year, but we choose to do the subpoenas next year, could they differentiate the people that were left from this year? Can we judge how much of a reaction we get from the letters and what percentage that takes? You see what I'm saying? Then we may have a better idea whether the subpoena is actually worth the money, next year.
And it can definitely be something that I can keep an eye on and get more engaged with and try to monitor. It's just honestly, I let Rita do their thing at this point just because I've had such a mountain of things ahead of me. But I could make this a priority that next year I will try to get more engaged and try to figure that out from 1 year to the next, see if it might be worth it for the next year to do this in a program if we don't.
I guess I'd also like to understand what their practice is of continuing to follow up to actually collect. But again, I mean, I hate to just blow off the fact that people haven't filed, and I realize if somebody doesn't live here, they don't have to file. But if people don't file, we don't know if they owe taxes. So at some point, the filing is pretty darn important.
Mm-hmm.
Right, because I know when they get to a certain point where we know someone owes us taxes, they do pursue that in small claims court at a certain point, or they can, we give them that direction. So, but again, we would have to know that that person owed us that money.
Right, the only way we know is that they've tried.
Because that tax liability doesn't go away, it's just whether there is tax liability.
This is a fairly substantial portion of local taxpayers, isn't it? I mean, people who work here that don't live here would be having to file as well.
Well, I also don't know how long somebody might stay on that list as well. You know, if somebody paid income taxes to the village 3 years ago, do they stay on that list until they're notified? If somebody keeps ignoring the letters year after year, how long do they stay on the list? That's a good question that I have myself. It's just not something that I've had a chance to dive into.
Question to ask them. I mean, that's some good information to have.
With the subpoena, is it really just I know what a subpoena is, but is it primarily called a subpoena so that it scares them a little more? I mean, what's it supposed to, is really the only service that they will come here and talk to people? You know what I mean? Or is it?
I know that when I asked them last year, once all the letters went out and people were starting to contact everyone, that I asked them if they would come out here, and they just told me that they didn't have the time to do it. So,
no, but if we do this subpoena, we pay this $8. Mm-hmm. It's really the only service we're buying that it looks more legal and they promise to come here.
And it's paying for their time.
And, I mean, what's the impact if somebody doesn't respond to that subpoena?
I'm not sure.
So you said we need to notify them by the end of the day, June 15th?
That's 5 o'clock.
Can I
ask a question about, I mean, this is a Chris Connor question maybe, but is it possible to insert into the resolution language that you're authorized to deduct for the subpoena program only for taxpayers who owe in excess of X amount? Can you put that in your resolution language to limit the $3?
The problem is we don't know what they owe if they haven't filed. We don't know if they owe a lot or nothing.
But the language of the resolution says the finance director is authorized to deduct from the monthly distribution check from Rita the amount expended for the subpoena program. That implies to me that Melissa would have discretion, and this resolution empowers her to do certain things. And since we've got the deadline, simply passing the resolution doesn't mean that she has to necessarily act on it, would it, Patty?
Correct. That's correct. If we pass it and she investigates further and doesn't believe that it's worth the time, then we can just go with the letter. We just don't enact the subpoena program.
But unfortunately, council's not going to have an opportunity to really know that, to make that decision.
Why not? Can't we get information before?
We can't deliberate. We can't make decisions outside of council.
No, what we would be saying is that it's Melissa's call. That we would be saying, we give her
Melissa and Patty's call.
Yeah, Melissa and Patty, we give them the authority to do this if they think it would be worthwhile. But
how about Melissa, Patty, Jerry, and myself?
I mean,
because Jerry's the finance person.
I probably wouldn't have a problem with that. I think I would like to hear from citizens if they're understanding this conversation. what's coming through and what you're thinking.
$8,000 for 2 days work is an awful lot of money.
Sam, come on.
Make you get your exercise. But it's supposed to be good for you. You're not supposed to sit. Every hour you're supposed to be back for 2 minutes, right? So
that hasn't been my heart. Hi, I'm Sam Young. Did somebody say 1,388? That's about a third of our population. And I would guess that that's probably somewhere around 80 or 90% of our households. There's something wrong here. I don't know what it is. I guess the first question I would ask is, how many returns have you received from Yona Springs? And I do a little research.
Thanks, Sam.
The whole thing seems absurd.
It does seem like a lot of letters.
Just as a point of reference, I've moved three times recently. Every time when I changed my address, they sent me a letter and told me that I needed to file it. In fact, I didn't. They just lost track of me. So their ability to track people is just not good. So I'm really doubting that they're really 1,300
people or anything. Failure to file.
In my family, there were four adult taxpayers at one point, and so then the two kids moved away. And so we got two people filing taxes, but two people who barely earned anything. You know, it's like summer job thing. So it really amounted to almost nothing. They moved away, but we got letters from Rita saying, what happened to these two taxpayers? Well, they really weren't taxpayers. And then there's the problem of moving,
right?
Other people moving.
Well, I would be comfortable having staff passing this resolution and having staff, whether Ron or Pete or Karen and Jerry, weigh in on it. Because while what you say, Lori, may well be true, on the other hand,
Any other comments from citizens? Yes, sir.
Jordan Gray, I'm a new resident, but I was wondering, someone was saying something about the data is not really available to like look through and parse through yourself. Is that right?
The names of the individual taxpayers that would be on the list, I think.
It's the comment that was made earlier about these being accumulative. I mean, could it be like so many massive years building up and just have this inflated number that's really not as scary as it feels? But just, I don't know if we can get partial data or anonymized data, partly.
First, the question, Melissa, did you say that it would just be so that they would come and help people who have questions? Right, wouldn't it be like more cost efficient just to pay somebody involved here in the village to figure out how the thing works and answer questions if villagers have questions instead of paying Rita $8,000 for 2 days and maybe have somebody that's
paying for the subpoena. We're not paying for that to come out. We're paying for the legal instrument. Chris, don't you agree? We're paying for the legal instrument of the subpoena.
That's correct. I mean, I'm not familiar with what actual subpoenas Rita sends out, but a subpoena by definition is a legal order that compels somebody to do something. I suspect that the sending out the subpoena triggers some next step on Rita by way of collection, but I don't know the answer unless I looked into that.
And that's what I guess I'm still trying to figure out, like what comes with that $8?
I have received the subpoena twice, and the way the subpoena reads, it states the year that they did not receive filing, and then they have a date on it when they will be in town, and you come down and meet.
So we must have done this in
the past. Yeah, we have done.
Jerry, what does it say, though, that the next step would be if you didn't come?
No. There,
it doesn't say.
There's no next step. It just said that you are to appear and here's 100 Dayton Street, and it gives the time that you are to appear.
So it is a subpoena to appear. Yeah, it's not a choice. Yeah.
Okay.
And in answer to Chrissy's question, part of the problem is that we do not have the access to Rita's records that show, did someone file? Did they not file? If they did file, was there a problem with their return? We don't have the access to those records, so that's why we couldn't necessarily help someone answer their question.
And yes, they have all the records, and in my case, I didn't know anything. So, it was a 5 minute, but they had three people available.
So, and Melissa, these 1388 would only be Yellow Springs citizens, currently or formally?
I assume. I asked them how many letters we would be sending out.
I mean, but they could be employees. I mean, they're people that owe
They could be
Yellow Springs income tax.
People
so
that
they
work
have
here.
To be employees.
I mean, I think that answers partially why it's...
Anybody who runs a food truck, for instance, is supposed to be paying taxes on that.
Contractors that are in town for more than a specific period of time, that kind of thing.
I would ask, is there a penalty for...
And be sure to say your name.
Tim Warhorst. Is there a penalty for not filing?
I wrote that down to ask.
Well...
Because if it's $8, then...
Yeah.
The penalty for not filing, if they determine that you owe an amount and you didn't pay it, it just adds...
So just the ones that we owe?
Yeah, it's a penalty on top of what I...
You don't owe anything.
Well, are we about ready to make a decision?
I think so. So Chris, your belief is that we could just go ahead, pass this resolution as it is, leaving open the option, and then the proposal would be that Chris, if necessary, Patty, Melissa, Jerry, and myself will, Melissa will get the information that we've asked, and we will make a decision as to whether to authorize her to move forward with this based upon what we find out.
And what I would say is then just make sure we get a report back from the staff or saying what decision was made.
And if we wait the next time, is we wait until next year?
I mean, I think we have two choices, to do that or to just vote it down, or vote it up. Vote it up or vote it down. So either, you know, we can.
So if we vote yes, we are voting to pass this, but it includes the idea that there's going to be further consultation by this subgroup that will then be reported back at the next meeting. If we vote no, then we could come back and make the decision next year. We can say, we're just going to let this year go.
Right. And that tax liability doesn't go away. I mean, we would still be able to collect.
It's still collected.
And it seems like there's a lot of work to be done. So, okay.
So I'll call the vote.
I think you need a motion to amend the resolution.
Well, I don't know that we need. That's to me is
it's more procedural.
It's procedural. I don't know that we would want to put that in the resolution anyway. If they want a copy of this resolution, I don't think we would want there to be any amendment to it personally. But that's really more a practice or procedure that we decided ourselves. So. Any other discussion or comments? So we'll call the vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
No.
Opposed?
Aye. I'm opposed.
Aye.
No.
But I would like this to be looked into more.
Yeah.
And then I might decide next year that we go ahead and let's look into these people.
Karen, if you agree, we can be bad.
Yeah.
And I mean to
look into it. So
no, I would like the letter to go out, though.
Yes.
That's free. Okay. The letter should
the
go
letter
out.
And then just gather the rest of the information. That way we have it for moving forward.
The letter should go out. People will be confused. We deal with them as we can.
Mm-hmm. And as an aside, I've seen at least one municipality that has left Rita for other. We used to work with the city of Dayton. I think that Rita is less expensive, but that might be something else to look into. Is there another resource? Is there another option? I think that this community ended up doing it themselves because of dissatisfaction. Service. Okay, we've got a lot of special reports. I see a lot of people here.
Citizens concerns.
Oh, I'm sorry. Citizens concerns. This is a time for items that are not on the agenda. You have 3 minutes. We ask that you step up to the microphone and state your name.
DJ Warren. Here today to update everyone on several things at the skate park here in the village. But before I do that, I first want to start off by sincerely thanking our village staff and members of the Public Art Commission alongside Grindline Skate Parks and of course every village council member here today for the hard work, dedication, and efficacy in providing the community with the necessary support needed to achieve the completion of Phase 1 at our park. Grand Line even provided extra features to the park during this, which they purchased locally and even stayed here in the village at the Spring Hotel. In the past few weeks, there's been an amazing amount of positive activity at the skate park. Not only from skateboarders in our community, but from the surrounding areas as well. There's even been several from out of state who have been absolutely blown away by the improvements that we've achieved. Many people, such as our city officials and police officers, were also amazed at this feat we were able to accomplish. Sorry, Aaron. And I did just want to mention, you know, in this process, where we are today, we have spent $40,000 successfully. We've implemented things appropriately, and there's a lot of excitement in the future for the completion of our master plan. And we have an event coming up June 13th, the same day as street fair, from looks like from noon to 5. And on that day, we will have a lot of musicians and skateboard contest lessons as well. And we'll also have a live art form. And several business owners are going to be sponsoring this event, as well as local skateboard companies, such as Centennial Skateboards and Red Rum Skate Company, and also Atomic Fox as well. And so what our goal is to achieve $90,000 additional funds, and we're attempting to meet that goal within 1 year. And we also do plan on going with Grindline to complete our master plan. And it's just something that's very amazing. I mean, anybody can go down there at any time on a given day when the sun's shining and see how much enthusiasm and how many people are really appreciated and, you know, what's been done here in this village. And I just wanted to express my sincere gratitude. And it's been a long time coming. And, you know, we're going to move on forward, and we just, you know, wanted to give our kids a safe place to skate and, you know, give the environment an aesthetically pleasing future. Thank you very much.
AJ, I wanted to thank you for all the work you've done. You've done an amazing job. You've got the skaters engaged, and that really helped a lot. So thank you so much. And you should be proud of the work you did.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, yeah. When I talk about... I mean, when I think about a community collaboration and sort of why I wanted to be on council, this is the project I refer to all the time. So thanks again, AJ.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Any other citizens' concerns? Seeing, hearing none, we will move on now to special reports. The first is the charter review report. I see committee chair here. Our attorneys here. I think we've got lots of people here that were involved.
My name is Sheila Miller. I was the chair of the Charter Amendment Committee, and you have your report, and you can see it's 30 pages long, so there's a lot there to look at. So I was kind of hit some highlights. In the middle of page 2 is where we have the charge from council. Just so that, you know, we were looking for identifying problems, identifying solutions, drafting language, and then submitting it to you, council, for your decision on what to go forward in terms of actually amending the charter. We have been working since early February. I think we did a pretty good job of getting through the whole charter and got most of what we needed. There were times where we said, you know, this could be more clear, but there's a certain, I think, ballot fatigue that you sets in. You think, well, that's going to be an awful lot of language to put on the ballot. But what we did first fell into two main categories. One is the recommendations that we're making to council for actual changes to the charter, and the other is a list of topics for consideration for council. And those were topics where, from the very beginning, we decided that we were not the policymakers, you know, council was the policymakers. Those were more policy-oriented decisions. We saw them as potential issues to be discussed. It was some of those were coming from actually coming from council, and so we kind of left those as separate for two different reasons. One is the policy making aspect of, you know, council, that's council's job. The other was that if this were to go on the ballot, the things that we are proposing are less controversial, are necessary in some cases, and ought to be separate from, if you decide to put some of the other language on the ballot, they ought to be two different issues. That's our proposal would be, first are the proposals we're actually recommending, and second was if you wanted to do something about those other issues, you might separate those issues on the ballot so that you don't lose the things that are sort of necessary to change. If you look at the language for the things that we're actually asking to change, there's four different categories. One is the typographical, and we have quite a few of those. An example would be section 4, which is on page 8, where you're just adding an S to make something plural because that makes sense. And so it's one of those things that it's really just adding one letter to that whole section. And those are the kinds of things that if you were to find, gosh, this is getting lengthy for the ballot, maybe some of those could be dropped depending on what you think is necessary or not. But those were things that we thought were important enough to make those small changes. The next is language clarification, and that comes to part of the charge where we were asked to clarify language and avoid the legalese. There's quite a few of those. And I would call your attention to section 3, page 7, where you will find that I think the language is much improved. From what was originally in the charter, we in general, when we change things have gotten shorter. And so we didn't get rid of all the legalese, but we got rid of a lot, and that's a good example of the type of thing that would be in that that language clarification section. And as I say, I think that's the most common change that we made. The third thing are what we called conformance changes, and that was to make things in the charter reflect the reality of how things get done. An example there would be section 8, page 8, for example, we would, and this was in several different places, where dates were provided in the charter for when things needed to be on a ballot. We just changed that to it will be in conformance with the election law in Ohio. There were a couple other changes. That's an interesting one there too. We got rid of the indelible pencil. Nobody knew what that meant. that petition could be signed by an indelible pencil. We allowing people to sign more than one person's nominating petition. But they're really more just, this is how things actually need to work. There were a couple places where we changed budgeting or projections from 6 years to 5 years, because that's what actually usually gets done. And then the next section are the substantive changes. And I think there's only six of those actually listed. And those were places where we actually changed something substantively. For example, Judy Kintner, the clerk of council, pointed out that there was a problem with the date of induction. So if you look at the induction of council, which is on page 10, that the date for induction of council did not conform with when the election would be certified. Greene County Board of Elections, and so we changed the date in order to make that so that it would be after that election results have been certified. There's another example there where sometimes in case the mayor was not available, we inserted the solicitor who would also swear in members of council in that way. It's, again, just to try and make it easier, but it is a substantive change. There's a difference in what the charter said and what how things would be working in the future. And I would say of those, probably the most important might be on page, section 63 on page 21. I highlight this in particular because I was on the last charter amendment committee. How I ended up on this one. And this was a change that was recommended by the committee but rejected by council. And this is about the requirement that one member of planning commission be from Miami Township. We changed the language there, if you look at it, to see that it is allowable. We would allow somebody to be outside of the village limits as a member of the planning commission, but it is not required. And it's not just Miami Township, it's outside the village limits. One of the things we talked about there is there are times when there might be an expertise that is not available in the village. If you wanted somebody on planning commission that had an expertise in historical restoration or something that might not be available, that might be. But that's one of the, that's I'd say probably one of the more substantive changes, and I call your attention to that. In particular, others would be, for example, right now we publish in the newspaper, but if an Ohio law requires that, if Ohio law were to change and allow publication of ordinances by posting on a website, that we have language in there that would allow that without having to go back and change the charter if Ohio law change. And then the topics for consideration, policy considerations by council. One is the merger of the clerk and the treasurer. We looking at the charter language, and I think we decided that was allowed under the charter, so we're not making any changes, but that's something that council would have to decide whether to do that. Whether the charter should be periodically reviewed is something that is in a lot of other charters. A lot of this, the village solicitor would bring in, this is what's going on in other municipalities. A lot of other charters have that language. We don't have that. And probably the biggest thing is that the office of the mayor, I think that came from council and the solicitors, that it is unusual that we have a separately elected mayor without having a strong mayor form of government, and so the mayor only operates the mayor's court. And so that's an unusual situation, and so that's, again, there's language there that potentially we would not have a separate election for mayor, but the mayor would have would be the highest vote getter as is president of council right now. And then there were some other sections 82 and 82 about the personnel policy manual, and there was some suggestion that the village manager ought to have more freedom to change the personnel policy manual without having that approved by council. And I think that was the that covers this what I call the substantive changes. Do you have any questions?
Before questions, I don't know about the rescue, but it was a big task, and I personally wanted to thank those that community members that volunteered: Aaron Sari, Jane Scott, Laura Perlis, Sheila Miller, Craig Messer, and Kate Walters. We met quite often, and we had very lengthy and sometimes a little heated discussions, but in the end, we were able to compromise and with our group like that. They did put in the time and the effort, and I thank what you got, what we came up with. I think we shouldn't have a whole lot of issues when it comes to our phone.
Yeah, and I would just add to that. I mean, when I kind of calculated it, we were in meetings for nearly 20 hours from February to May, and there was plenty of prep time. And I was also really impressed, as Jerry mentioned, that even when I kind of felt like maybe we had talked about it way long, that we finished the discussion, and that was great. And you know, on top of that, it was really nice to have Patty and Judy involved. I mean, kudos to our village solicitor, because there were, I can't even imagine how many hours was spent on this project. But it was a really diverse group, and we really drilled down on these things, and I was really impressed. So thank you.
Yeah, and also our assistant solicitor was really very helpful in the process.
Thanks to everybody. I agree. It seemed like a good process, very quick and very thorough. I would like somebody to explain the election process, the ballot process, and exactly what the ballot is going to look like, whether each of these is a separate issue. I don't know if that's you, Sheila, or if that's Chris.
Maybe Chris is better at this than I am, but I would say, having done this before, it was all one issue, all of the changes. That's why we broke down what that in that first section for the, I guess the, will be section 4 of your report, where it goes through all of the changes. That would be, in our view, one ballot issue. But if you could, again, change things and say, you know what, I'm afraid that that's going to be too controversial, so you can take, I think it's up to you to how many issues you want to make it.
To clarify that, I have the ordinance from, or at least a draft ordinance, I presume it was the one that was passed. There were actually two ballot initiatives. The second issue involved the membership of Planning Commission. So it can be split up based upon a determination of if there's a sense that maybe some item is a little bit more controversial, there'll be more public debate, because some of these changes really are non-substantive or really need to happen, and you don't want to jeopardize the body of work. So we can break it into as many initiatives or ballot components as we feel is appropriate to still accomplish the goal and let the electorate determine the significant issues.
And it's really then obviously us that will make that determination?
Yes, but I think that...
And what's our time frame for November?
It's 90 days before the election. I mean, I think based upon the initiatives, early August.
And who will be handling that? Patty, Judy?
Judy normally files the things with it, unless she's out of town.
So council, as far as the, how do we want to go about it? And I think we could probably get most of dispatch with most of this today, at tonight's meeting. Some of the broader issues may take more discussion. Yes. I would say, is everybody comfortable with this first section that are typographical language clarification and conformance changes, that would be one ballot issue?
I think so, yeah.
I do have a question about typographical things. Sometimes it looked like you were taking out like when it says 11690, for example, right at the bottom of page 8, what is that?
That was the last time the charter was amended. Because this is a working document, those dates would change based upon the amendments that we would be putting forth on the ballot if it were adopted. So those dates will be removed at some point.
Oh, okay. Okay, so it looked like Brian had removed one, and I was just feeling kind of...
It was in the wrong place in the document.
Oh,
but yeah.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
But yeah, all, you know, those dates, anything we change and it's approved, will be updated.
Okay, all right. Thank you. That's just, that's me being confused.
I do have one question though. The page 10, the first day of the, when a new council member is being sworn in. So if we do it before, on or before January 1st, that means they're going to be sworn in the second meeting in December. Is that what we're wanting, or do we want them sworn in the first meeting in January?
What we're going to do is, once the Board of Election, the election is certified, at any time up to January 1st, it doesn't have to be within the context of a board, of a council meeting. The office takes effect January 1. The swearing in can take place before then.
Before, once it's certified.
So the oath of office and the swearing in is not the same thing, or?
Well, I would say it this way. We've got official and then we've got ceremonial.
Okay.
There may be, you may, for ceremonial purposes, want to swear in the entire council at the first meeting, hypothetically January 3rd, but all council members would already have legally been sworn in to take the office effective January 1.
Okay.
And some of the rationale behind that, that we got into the same budget issue, the way it is now, right after the election, that next meeting, you take your seat. And if we hadn't completed the budget, we could have possibly three new council members that had no real discussion with the budget, but it had to be done by for the first year this way, that should be done, and start including themselves. Just, we just thought it would be easier to start at the first event.
And I suppose potentially you could have an election that came out announced one way the night of the election and have it reneged, or when they recounted in a small village, it could come down to a few votes on a given seat. So you could potentially seat the wrong person since we do it so quickly.
Right.
So the election happens, and then within two weeks, we've traditionally had the new council, and technically one of them could have to be unseated if the certified results were different. Am I correct?
Yes.
If you passed any legislation or anything in that time period, it would be not so good at all.
Right. So even though that's perhaps feels like a big change to Yellow Springers, I view it, because of that legal issue, even more than the practical issue that Jerry identified, I view it as more of a, that second category has such nice things. So the thing to keep it in compliance with.
Conformance.
It's more of a conformance issue.
It is, and there's a best practice issue too, in my view, that came out because of the budget process. That you have the council body has been working on the budget. If you bring a new person in the middle of a budget discussion, it impacts the continuity, and frankly, we've been approving our budgets late. And so the theory would be that a budget could actually be approved before the new council comes in, and that's a best practice, I think.
So just so I understand, the oath of office on or before January 1st, but they will not officially be council members until January 1st.
Correct.
So there's no, okay, so that I just wanted to be clear on that.
And there was also some concern that council members had their full term, so had their 2 years or 4 years. That was brought up in the discussion as well, so that we made sure that we kind of made that from January to December 31st.
That should make it easy for Melissa.
Right, having everybody's terms begin and end at the new year as opposed to 8 weeks before.
Okay, so let's start it. Let's say first that we have agreed that the first two or three categories. Typographical, language clarification changes, and conformance changes. We're all agreed that we're accepting those as they've been presented. Because I realized that that one was actually a substantive change.
No, it's not. It's a conformance change.
No, it says substantive change.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
Okay, well.
So that looks like that's the first substantive change in here. The next substantive change is appointment of village manager. And that is related to, so the change is that an ex-council member or elected official cannot be the village manager until 2 years after leaving office. Is that, that's the change, correct?
Yes, and let me look at this for a second.
I think the main change there was that you're adding in the mayor, depending on whether you are separately elected, the mayor, as it's written now, that would include anybody who's elected, which would...
So it's anybody who's elected.
And it also clarifies, because there was some discussion about a charter commission, which can be elected, people could be elected to be on a charter commission versus a committee, which we were appointed, and the change is actually coming from council, and that's to sort of remove that you could be on the committee but not an elected official, which would be if you were elected to a charter commission.
Right. So is everybody in agreement with that?
So it has always been that no one serving on village council
could
be. We're just making sure that it applies to all elected officials.
Right. Because the discussion initially came up, but why would we put this restriction on the committee? And then we started to think it's really about elected, and that's what Sheila mentioned about, one way to do a charter initiative is to elect a commission as opposed to appoint a committee.
Let me ask council a question. Do we want to try to dispatch as much of this as possible? Like, what I'm thinking is, like that, if we go back to the substantive change on the swearing in of council, do we want that to be a separate ballot issue? I mean, do we want to try to get through this as much as possible until we get to the discussion items? How quickly do we want to get through this tonight?
Can I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
My suggestion would be identify what you want on the ballot, and then in the context of me drafting the proposed legislation, let me submit something to you and then consider it.
Okay. So we're okay with this Section 18 thing. Next is substantive change. It's a procedure for passage of ordinances, first reading. That's just about the notification of citizens, right? Just leaving it more flexible. Okay. Are we all okay with that?
Yeah.
So that's just how we publish information to the public about ordinances, and it allows more flexibility as to how and where we do that.
Then with the village manager appointment, section 30, it looks like there is a bit of substantive change regarding residency. Could you address that, Sheila?
Well, that is based on actually case law from Ohio that states that you cannot force somebody to live in the village. And so we also talked about the fact that there's contractually a lot of that is taken care of with the contractual, but that in the charter there is some case law that states that that these residency requirements cannot be enforced. So
in other words, you could put it in a contract that you're making a person sign, but you can't put it in like a charter or a founding document, really, and have it be in any way legally enforceable.
I should say, you can have trouble enforcing that in the contract, too, but that's just...
I always understood that we couldn't, even in a contract.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
unless the person agrees.
So, right, so the, so the language within Greene County or an adjacent county, that's acceptable?
That's within the that's in the new statute that was passed, and that was what was reviewed by the Ohio Supreme Court.
Okay. Next is the, on page 16, section 39, adoption of the budget. So this has to do with removing a 10-day period between the reading and the enactment. And so it basically, it would
go into effect immediately upon passage of the second reading.
Okay. Is everybody okay with that one? Next substantive change is...
Yeah, I think we should talk about just section 44 briefly, because while it's a conformance change, just to make clear, the Board of Elections and state law sets the when matters have to be presented to get on the ballot. Our charter was not consistent with state law, and so that conformance change, while it has the appearance of being substantive, is really just to say we have to comply with law, but it's important to know that it doesn't change the process. You just the date, the timing of the dates that you have to get it there.
Looks like the next substantive change is related to the Planning Commission, related to page 21, section 63, membership, and that's related to the language change that would allow but not require one member to be not only outside or not only in Miami Township, but potentially outside of the township. So that is probably, I was on that council when it was recommended and rejected. I think it was rejected by council because of the feeling of the closeness and collaboration of Miami Township and the village, and that's why it was rejected. My personal feeling is that I would support this language that leaves it optional, because I think that we have had some difficulty finding that member that has enough understanding and knowledge of the village to serve.
And desire.
To serve.
I have a question, just a little, like I've noticed a couple of places where spaces were left out. I assume that's kind of thing will just get cleared up.
That's correct. I mean, the formatting sometimes when you do this red line and it's hard to catch some of the spacing. Although I will say this, somebody else who needs thanks is Brian. He is one of the best editors I've ever worked with. I defy you to get a typo past him.
Yeah, so there's just a couple of things where spaces were accidentally.
So, are we okay with this content?
Yes. Mm-hmm. As the person who was really struggling to get the right people on the plan, I think we did a good job, by the way, and I think we have great people on there. I'm glad to have somebody from Miami Township. But we had a member from Miami Township who actually really kind of wanted to step down, but out of the goodness of his heart stayed on while I tried to find somebody to take his spot. So we were kind of holding him hostage, which is not a good situation. That wasn't great for, I don't think that's what the spirit of the idea is.
The next that's noted as substantive is on page 22, section 69, initiative. But again, that language basically just references the type of notification for an initiative, and just allowing public media or some sort of media other than the newspaper. Is everyone okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Looks to me like the next one is the biggie. Well, I think then we go to basically the policy.
Maybe just a couple words on the recall election, why that language was clarified. I know that some member was
wasn't that because we had, it was confusing when we actually did the recall and what actually means?
Well, it wasn't a recall, that was the referendum.
Oh, that was referendum, I'm sorry.
But we will talk about recall in section five.
Oh, that's what it follows. But there is some clarifying language in the recall section as well, I believe.
But the referendum section.
Minimal.
The referendum section, the recall section. It's taking out the gendered language.
Right, well, I mean, ultimately, we were concerned that, I mean, I guess we also have to think about, there are changes here that need to be passed in the ballot, and there are areas where we wanted to improve the language further, but that could become confusing, and maybe a reason it doesn't pass.
So which one are you talking about?
Recall, you know, because again, you know, we don't want it to appear that we're trying to change, you know, the process. But we did think the gender issue was important enough, since that was supposed to be fixed in all the sections.
So it looks like, so we've really gotten to the end then of what would, of everything but the policy discussions that we might want. So at this point, do we at least want to direct Chris to pull together those particular topics and or those amendments and present them back to us in whatever ballot format he would recommend?
And I just want to mention two things that I think we can discuss when we get that. The two areas for me personally where I worry about it creating an issue on the ballot is the village manager residency. I understand that that's conformance with the law, but I just worry about if all the changes that need to happen don't get passed because there's some confusion there. And the second one, if the Planning Commission membership was a challenge before, I just want us to think about that. So it doesn't mean I don't think it should be one initiative, but we do have that option where we can separate things to make sure that things that need to change do change.
So Chris will present those, and when you, depending upon, maybe if you would note all of the ones, those two especially, and if there's any others that you think maybe should be separated out as a substantive.
Should at least be flagged so that we can.
What you're likely to see is a draft to you that breaks it out into all the discrete potential. In other words, go to the one that is the least controversial. By that I mean we could end up with six ballot components, and then you say, okay, well, what does it look like, and then we can consolidate it more, or and that will help you determine what should get to the ballot or what shouldn't. So that's what I'm thinking.
Right. And I think we're agreed that we want all these to get to the ballot, just how are they going to be presented?
Yeah, it's a matter of how it's going to be split up. Is everything that we've just discussed non-controversial enough that it can just all go as one, or
I don't know. We haven't spoken enough about section five yet.
No, we're not.
Well, I know. Yeah, we're not. That's what. So okay.
Yeah, no. That's what I'm saying. Everything that we've just discussed that we've said you can deal with. And we're not expecting to get through section five.
And now, there may be a few we can't. So now, let's move on. Let's spend a few minutes talking about section five and deciding what we're going to do with it. So it looks like the merger of the council clerk and treasurer's position is a non-issue. We can just pull that off because we can choose to do that by ordinance rather than by the charter.
Right.
Or resolution.
Okay.
Yeah, the charter allows us to do that if we ever choose to.
So that seems like a non-issue. Amend the charter to require charter reviews. What does anybody think about that?
Our current one does not list of specific.
We are not required to conduct a charter review on a set schedule. Some municipalities say they do it every 5 years or a designated set period of time. The history of the village's charter reviews, the charter was initiated or was passed in 1950. The first charter review was 1990. The second was 2007. And now in 2015, we're doing another. My view is that it's a time-consuming, expensive process. And that I don't think a village of this size needs to have a set time to do it. There's enough awareness of whether or not the charter's functioning between input from the manager, the solicitor, other staff, council can sense it, and frankly, the community can too. I mean, one of the things that triggered this charter review was the realization that the initiative procedure was just, was hard to figure out how to do it. And villagers and people shouldn't have to sit down and parse some words out to figure out something that ought to be straightforward. So I have faith in the common sense of the community without having to mandate it every set term.
Okay. Is everybody in agreement with that?
No.
Okay, I propose that for the minute we skip the next deal related to mayor and council president and move on to D, recall charter sections, and decide what we want to do about those. Or to me, all these other sections kind of go together and are clearly going to take a lot more time to discuss.
So it's just saying that we would just follow Ohio law.
Right. Is there a reason that has been identified as controversial just because we had a recall election?
Well, I think so. I mean, I think that there's this general sense that, okay, we're going to go in there. We've got these three charter sections that have, you know, 200 words. And when we first, as the committee, I think that it takes a while for a committee to find its way. And when we first reviewed it, those sections, we said, you know, this is probably beyond the scope. But then when we went back, as we had finished the project and started to talk about what else we wanted to do, we came to the realization that the language in Section 72, 3, and 4 is very, very difficult to read. And we've got clean state law on this. And I think it's easier for people if they say, okay, I've just got to follow Ohio Revised Code. Today's world, you can Google that. You could find out what that process is. And I think that it would, if the community were to go through another recall, I think it would be easier for citizens to start that process because they don't have to, go through this charter and dissect what it says with its archaic, clunky language.
And if Ohio would change its law, then they don't have to try to figure out, wait, the charter says this, then I looked up the Ohio and it says this, which do I follow? You know, they don't have to try to parse that
exactly.
out.
Exactly. So that if that charter amendment were adopted by the voters, it could last forever.
So is what is written here, proposed Section 72 recall, So the ballot issue would say removing Section 72, 73, or Section 73 and 74. The proposed Section 72 recall would just be those three lines. Would
yes.
be as simple as that?
Yes. And then 73 and 74 would be vacated or some language to indicate as a placeholder that the sections would still be identified in the charter because we don't want to renumber the charter because everything would have to go back on the ballot.
Right.
Okay. I mean, I think this seems very reasonable.
Is Ohio law, is that easy to interpret what it says?
The answer is statutes can be difficult sometimes, but I think that the Ohio statutes tend to be more easily understood. But more importantly, the boards of elections, other lawyers, when they're giving advice to people who are interested in recall, they're more familiar with that process. So, for example, during the initiative issue, I had a contact with a lawyer who had been hired by the group, and we had to have discussions, and I kind of had to walk them through how Judy and I were interpreting the charter, and because that was a friendly effort, we got through it, of course. But there's pitfalls when you go through this. I mean, it's you'd be surprised at how many challenges there are that fail based upon procedural technicality. And I think that we concluded that we wanted to, if citizens wanted to participate in that process, that they shouldn't fail because of procedural technicality.
Mm-hmm. So I guess that makes me wonder, could we or should we be doing the same thing to the initiative and the referendum sections?
Well, you know, we looked at that, and we think that the language that we included made it easier. So I kind of defer to counsel on that. Sheila, I don't know if you have any comments, but I felt that we cleaned that language up so it was much easier to read.
Yeah, I think that we did, but that option is always open to say, you know, follow the Ohio Revised Code.
Brian or Jerry, do you have anything?
Well, one argument that came up is that, a counter argument is that it's nice to be able to look at the charter and see what those steps are. So if we agree that those are clear and conform, then that's one reason not to touch it. My other concern is just how many things we start to put on the ballot.
Right.
That's, I don't know, I just think it can get it muddy.
Is there a way, but aren't we looking at the same possibility though, that if we go into some detail on those two sections and Ohio Revised Code changes, then we're against the code? Is there a sentence, should we put in or per Ohio Revised Code or something? I mean, should we, at least so that we don't have to, if something changes, we don't have to update our charter?
We certainly can.
Yeah. I mean, I think that might make sense, yeah.
As a lot of five.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. So is everybody okay with this recommendations on section 72? Okay. And then the classified employees, could you explain that, Sheila?
Yes, I think it was in particular on, there was a problem with in 81, talking about appropriate probationary period, because that does not necessarily exist, and that that there might be some thought that would give somebody an idea that they did have a probationary period when they're all at-will employees. I think that was or that they might, that's done by the personnel policy manual. So that was one thing. The other thing was that the council shall adopt by ordinance a comprehensive personnel policy, and the idea was that, does that give the village manager sufficient freedom to change the personnel policy without having to go back to council and for what might be considered minor changes? So I think those were issues that were raised. There was disagreement, I think, amongst the committee on that, and so we did not end up having a changes. Yeah.
Patty, do you want to chime in on this?
There was a discussion as to whether the personnel manual should be a policy or a procedure. Because the village manager doesn't set policy, the village manager sets procedure, council sets policy. And so there was a discussion as to whether the personnel manual should be considered a policy or a procedure. My particular point of view is that it should be considered a policy that is adopted by council to be applied equally to all village employees.
That's so you can live with the current wording?
I have no problem with the current wording on those two sections.
That's certainly been our practice. Usually it's written effectively by manager in consultation with usually a committee of people chosen by employees. And then
we
get it and we approve it or disapprove it.
And the discussion as to the probationary period was, there was some feeling on the committee that if an employee had a probationary period, that at the end of that period, that the employee felt so vested in their job that they felt they could not be removed. I also disagree with that. I think that, correct circumstances, if you document the issues, that any employee can be removed from employment if there's just cause. So I personally do not have a problem with either one of these two sections, although there were people on the committee that did disagree with them.
Chris?
My view is that when it comes to this type of change, one, I think great deference needs to be given to the manager who's actually got to implement these policies. Two, it's a much, much broader discussion in the context of a charter amendment than our committee was tasked with doing. I mean, these are substantive type changes that impact the village employees, and I frankly, again, my view singularly was I think this was really beyond the scope of what our mission was, and so from my perspective, I was very comfortable with any recommendation that we not change this.
It's kind of, if it isn't broke, don't fix it, and it doesn't seem to really actually be broken.
And I just realized we're way over, given the fact that we have two more reports. This clearly, this whole mayor discussion, these two or three pages related to the mayor, council president, will require other discussion. Do we want to have that discussion, or do we just want to dispatch it now? We'll what we'll do is add it to future agenda items if we want to have that discussion.
I think there are people here who wanted to at least share their views on it, so. So I would like, I think providing, we've got the opportunity to provide a little context. I know we don't want to spend a lot more time, but I think we should probably do that since it was on the agenda and I had some calls about it this afternoon.
Specifically about the mayor's situation? Okay. Citizens that want to speak to this?
Well, I think context is important first. I'd like to just maybe...
I can tell you that this did not come from the committee.
Right.
I felt like it came from solicitor, but kind of council.
Yeah.
And so, I think as a committee, we had a very lengthy discussion. The only person who showed up to talk to us, other than it was on the committee, was the current mayor, and we did have a discussion about that. And that was probably one entire meeting.
Okay.
Does anyone know if there's anyone who wants to talk?
Yeah, I think so. I see. Were you planning to speak to it? That's what I thought.
Should we maybe summarize? Because the one thing that I think that we wanted to be very, very clear about was that this whole discussion had nothing to do with Mayor's Court. Mayor's Court, under any of the changes that were even thought about here, mm-hmm. would still exist as part of the village. And so I think that was one of the things and correct me if I'm wrong, but we wanted to make sure that everyone understood that the entire discussion had absolutely nothing to do with the function of Mayor's Court.
I will say, I mean, I'm sorry to disagree with you, Lori, but this is a very long and intense discussion because there is a lot to be discussed and a lot to be described. I think we need to put it off.
Put it at the next meeting?
Yeah. Or at a future meeting.
Well, we're running, the only problem is that we're running short of time.
Right, right. Next regular meeting would be ideal.
We counted backwards, and this has to be at the Board of Elections by August the 5th.
Right.
So
I think we definitely, because I think it's going to be more than one meeting. That was my main concern, was that we have plenty of time because it takes a while for citizens to roll into something.
And it could be that it's too big of a discussion for this particular ballot.
And that's my feeling.
So, but I just feel like we've got two reports tonight and that...
Okay, well...
And I don't know, Sheila, I mean, I would say that it's possible that for that discussion, I don't know that you would need...
I think the idea was
the ball's in your court.
Yeah. wasn't
well, thank you very much for presenting. Chris, did you get clear direction?
I think so. The one clarification I need is on the issue of the initiative petition. My task is to present what may be perceived as one simpler language and two something that says that will comply with that would comply with Ohio law. So there was the simpler language part of it too.
No, all I do is just for it.
Just compliance.
Just a reference to the ORC.
Okay.
Should we at least let people?
I can come back.
We usually hear things, but see, sorry.
But maybe, should we at least?
Any other comments about the, about what Sheila's discussed, what we've decided so far on the charter review? Jane, thank you.
It's a lot to take in. Please feel free to write us, you know, especially if you have time for things to soak in. I mean, these people worked on this for months. Have a lot of time to think about it, and it's a lot to take in.
Okay.
Dan has a quick.
Dan.
May I ask from here?
If you would, thanks.
Hi, it's Dan Rice. I know you guys are trying to move on to the other issues on the agenda, but the thing that occurred to me with the issue that you were, or part of the committee's work that you were wanting to put to a different meeting about the mayor and the reconfigurations there. And my hunch is that the village, folks in the village who are going to see this for the first time will be surprised by it. And I was wondering, is it possible either here in a short form or before it comes up again to provide some context for how that came about? I think someone there just said that this came out of retreat for in a way. And in any case, it's from someone who's fairly frequently in the audience, and I think it's finding it a little surprising. I think it will indeed need some context for you to have a productive discussion. I'm not trying to have that discussion right now. But some more context. Jerry, you were trying to.
Yeah, when you get that.
Yep.
Thanks.
Okay.
But again, to make it perfectly clear, the committee did not make any recommendations on any changes to the section of the charter as it related to the mayor. Okay? None whatsoever. So, the discussion and what the committee said, if there were anything about mirror, they were throwing it back to council in a council discussion. We said, you know, it was above, basically above pay grade. So we as the committee have nothing to report back to the community on the section on the mayor's court.
Well, but it wasn't mayor's court. This is going to make it even more confusing.
I'm sorry. On the section that related to mayor. So, but we didn't get into that discussion. We okay. Felt the charter was fine the way it is.
Can I ask a follow-up question? And this is honestly my not fully understanding the process, and if I can refer to the current charter, I suspect, and figure out what this would be. But for something as a charter modification to find its way onto the ballot, doesn't it have to come out of a charter committee or are other paths? So there are multiple paths for
yes.
A charter revision. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, and there's three actually. I'll send that to you.
Okay. We'll discuss when exactly this is going to be on the agenda. During agenda planning. Okay. We're going to take a 5-minute recess. In place and ready. Next on the agenda, and I'm seeing folks here to discuss it, we have the Climate Action Plan discussion. We received a proposal from Environmental Commission, I suppose. Is that where it came from?
Yeah.
Okay. Marianne or Deward, is that who's going to start?
Deward wrote the recommendations. The Environmental Commission reviewed them at our last meeting, works these recommendations, and Deward agreed for you to present.
Just a summary.
So I'd like to thank the council for hearing these recommendations from the Environmental Commission on this important subject. I'd also like to note that I should have updated the timeline. The timeline should be 2 to 3 months in the future, because when this was initially drafted for various people to review, there were some scheduling issues with presenting to the council. So add 2 to 3 months to all of those timelines, if you would, please. This really breaks down into a main recommendation, 3 secondary recommendations that are kind of short putts, things that we're kind of already doing that make sense, and then 1 kind of open-ended recommendation. The main recommendation is that that the village move forward with formal climate action planning. And the justification is that's how we as a village are going to be able to develop a plan that is specific to our unique situation. In general, people understand the things that make sense from a climate perspective, but Yellow Springs is a unique community. We're already doing a lot of things, completing a formal climate action plan will give us the basis for knowing the specific things that we need to do. Creating a climate action plan, a formal climate action plan, involves, first off, joining an organization that can provide you the necessary assistance, the tools, the experience to develop that plan. The primary organization here in the U.S. is ICLEI, Local Governments for Sustainability. They do a lot of things and provide a lot of value through the things that they provide to local communities, but that's the primary organization that provides the tools and the structure for climate action planning. So that's the first part of the recommendation, is that we join that organization so that we can access the tools to move ahead. The actual climate action planning process starts with a baselining process, and that process, the timeline, 9 months is a somewhat aggressive timeline. It's certainly doable. I think we have a lot of the information that we already need. There's a lot of work that still needs to be done, but that's the first part of the process. The second part of the process then is to establish goals for the community. So once you understand where you're at, you then establish goals. Once you have those goals established, the third part of the process is developing a plan for reaching those targets. And so, say for instance, with electricity, if we establish a goal of being, I'll just throw a number out there, say 90% renewable energy, and we know we're somewhere around 80, that would be developing a plan on how to get to that additional 10% by whatever timeline we would establish for that. And then the final part of the plan is actually doing what you decide to do and actually implementing those changes and implementing the plan. So that's the main recommendation. I thought it might be good just to stop there and have a discussion about that. If you have any questions.
And this will all come from, the climate action plan will come from Environmental Commission, or is that the group that will be developing it?
Well, I think in actually having discussions with individuals that I think are individuals on the Energy Commission, they can certainly play their role as well.
And the support provided by ICLEI, you believe that you could write the climate action plan without additional funding?
There are definitely communities that do that, and that would be what our primary objective would be. If we can, with resources that we have, it's primarily the baseline, that's the biggest challenge. There's also been some discussion around potentially getting an intern from either Antioch or UD has a program that can be applicable. That's where the biggest piece of the work is, and I think it makes the most sense, considering where the village is at from a financial perspective, to at least on our first attempt to try to do this without external. And we also have a lot of very qualified people in Yellow Springs that are involved with this.
Do you want to talk about the resilience network in relation to this? as far as the other support?
Sure, yeah, so there is, you might have heard of the group that came out of, started with the Climate March, and then Media Solutions held a conference, and that evolved into a group that is known as the Village Springs Resilience Network, and it actually involves a real diverse group of people from our community. There's interfaith organizations, there's representation from Antioch, the Energy Board, the Environmental Council, Community Solutions, Green County Green Environmental Coalition. And that group actually reviewed these recommendations. We had, they were out far enough in advance, and they're very supportive of this. The group in general sees this as the first and most important step to taking climate action. There are a lot of other things that that group is doing, but they're very much supportive of moving forward with a formal climate action plan.
And so other organizations would potentially be willing to invest their resources. I guess my thing is not wanting to get into this and then come back and say, oh, we need thousands more for consultant fees. And you know, be at a point where a lot of work has been done, but it can't be completed without spending additional thousands of dollars.
So there are no hard reasons why we would need that money. There are communities that have ended up in that place where they didn't have the resources and support for completing their climate action plan, but eventually did get there, and actually Overland was one of them. They their whole initiative was really kind of kicked off by a student and got the funding and started moving ahead with establishing a baseline. They decided to revisit that and restart and go at things more formally down the road. That turned out really well for them. I think the biggest risk that we have, honestly, is getting to a finished plan and then not doing anything about it. I think that getting to a finished plan is something that is not going to be a big challenge for our community. Because it doesn't have to be, there's no certification that in fact is a plan. So if we run into, say for instance, some big barriers around really understanding transportation in Yellow Springs, there's no reason that we can't say, we're going to put that on a side burner for now and address the issues that we can.
Yeah, I want to say I'm very impressed, and that's why I wanted the Resilience Network to be brought up, is because it reminds me of how we approached the fiber initiative, in that we have this very talented, strong, motivated group who's willing to collaborate with our commissions, and that makes me feel really confident about it.
Okay. Do you want to go on to the rest?
Sure. Yeah, the next three recommendations are kind of related to things that are already happening, are kind of no-brainers relative to any climate action plan. The first one, just put simply, and I'll cut through to the chase, any local affordable renewable energy is a good thing, regardless of the model, relative to climate action. Right? That will, that's one of the biggest ways for us to lower our carbon footprint and our greenhouse gas emissions. So that's, you know, we should do whatever we can in that area. The next one is around promoting energy conservation, and there's the term curtailment also really applies. It's not specific to energy, but that's a term that's in the minds of people in Yellow Springs. So creating a program around energy conservation for Yellow Springs is a no-brainer. It will be part of a climate action plan. There's really no reason, we have programs that are available, there's really no reason that we can't move ahead with that in the near term. Okay. And then the final one, which is in line with what's taking place with the waste contract, is that climate action considerations should really be integrated into all village contracts, and there's really two sides to that. There's the consideration of what the vendor or what the purchase, the impact of that from a climate perspective. And then there's another consideration, which is if somebody provides that service in that way, or we buy those goods and use them in that way, what is that going to lead to from a behavior perspective for people in the village? For instance, with the waste contract, looking at different options around composting, which were considered, or looking at different options from a pay-as-you-throw, or incenting people not to generate as much trash. are, that's that type of consideration that can be integrated into contracts as well. And then the last one, which is kind of a looking into the future, there's going to be a lot of opportunities to do additional things related to climate action before we have a formal climate plan in place. And those things are likely to relate both to economic opportunities. There are a lot of organizations in town that do things that are that provide services, business services relative that are in some way related to climate action, whether that's energy efficient housing or retrofitting or locally made goods or local food. There's a lot of things there, so there's going to be some opportunities from an economic development perspective. And there will also be opportunities related to equity and inclusion. Certainly as we move ahead, any climate action plan, there are a lot of opportunities to improve people's quality of life through the actions you take relative to climate change.
Given, well, first of all, thank you, Lewis, because I know you put a lot of given that we don't want to take a lot of time now, and that this will be a living document, what do you feel like you would want to see as the next person, something from council that would be like a next step?
The next step would be to task the Environmental Commission and the Energy Board with moving forward the climate action planning process and joining in play. It's really hard to move forward with that process without access to the tools that they've developed. Those would be the primary two things that we would need to move ahead.
Is there anything that council or staff would want to know about more about the organization, which stands for International Council for Local Environmental Initiatives? And I guess maybe they decided...
It actually doesn't stand for that anymore. It's like Hewlett-Packard, yeah,
BHP. They decided that was too much.
Yeah, so they retired that. So.
I think I didn't have the opportunity to look at their website, so I would need to know more about it. Mm-hmm. I do think there's opposition from HRC that they feel like their budget's been cut. But certainly a good case would have to be made that it really served the mission of HRC.
I think I can address that. I think Melissa would be willing to investigate whether the $600 could come from the Green Space Fund. I think that would be an appropriate place for that if council chooses to move forward.
It could also come from the electric fund, since so much of this is electric. It's energy based. What does it have to do with HRC?
That's where they were spending the money. Said the money would come from
HRC.
Yeah, it says it right in the document.
Yeah.
This was an offline discussion that Brian and I had, and there are, honestly, if you look at climate change and the impacts of climate change, it's really an equitable issue because the people who are going to be impacted the most are the people that are in lower income brackets, and there's even some racial divides if you look at the issues from a global perspective as well. So
I don't think it's a cool thing to go into HRC, but especially without discussing it with
HRC. No, I think, you know, if we decide this is the way we should go, then
we find the money for it.
We tell Melissa what to take.
So does council feel like it would like more information about
more information on equity? Yes. And it, maybe their membership. I assume Overland's a member.
Yes, I think yes. There are six.
There are six communities in Ohio, and I can almost remember them: Akron, Alliance, Athens, Cleveland, Overland.
That's okay. I think we should end this discussion and come back to.
How about if we come back with more information about ICLE and maybe also contact some of the communities that have joined them and get some feedback.
Right. Yeah, that would be great.
That would be great.
Okay. And then if you make any modifications to this document or whatever, just make sure it's identified by who's presenting the date and
yeah,
just so we can keep track of,
yeah, put it in the documentation, just so we, so that we have that, it's easier to track,
just so we, it's identified.
So we're looking for more information about ICLEI. ICLEI is a very diverse organization. So are there specific things that we're looking to?
What are the benefits of being involved in it? What specific concrete things is somebody like Oberlin using?
I think maybe contacting Athens and Oberlin. We can contact some of the communities in Ohio and join and get some feedback from
them. Can do. Based upon my my conversations with people from some of those other communities, the primary benefits are the tool sets that they provide. There's a lot of other things that are interesting about the organization, but it's primarily the tool sets.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Jennifer. And let's do Environmental Commission. Now I see representatives of SpringsNet to give a report on fiber forum.
Tim Barhorst, I'm a member of SpringsNet and the Community Access Panel. And I'd like to report a little bit on our successful fiber forum on May 25th. We had approximately 70 participants, and we heard from 8 different speakers. And for those that were unable to attend, we published the whole fiber forum now on YouTube. And you can get to it by just going to yellow-springs.net and picking the fiber forum tab if you want to watch the over 3 hours of video. Or you can go to Yellow Springs News. Amy Magnus did an excellent job of blogging the whole event and did a really nice detailed overview of the whole event if you want the short version. I'm not going to go through all the speakers and what they said, but I do want to make note of two that struck me as being particularly relevant to our issue. Greg Dunn from Columbus really stressed the point of how the current political environment is very favorable for this kind of build-out of our infrastructure. Ohio's administration and the federal administration, though they're completely opposite in their political parties, both see broadband, especially fiber right now, as a smart investment. And he noted that advisors at the Federal Communications Commission indicate the influence of major telecommunication companies is at a low ebb due to some of the recent FCC rulings to that regard. The other speaker that I found inspiring was Jeremy Pietzoit of Sandy, Oregon, especially because Sandy, Oregon is a very small community, has a lot of similarities to our village. And I've been in touch with him. I've actually gotten quite a bit of budgetary information about their project since the forum. And becoming familiar with how they approach the build out of their infrastructure, which they're currently involved in, I think they're about 50% of the way through the build out. But they wrote a letter recently with Jeremy, who is the current city council president, and his mayor, wrote a letter to the Federal Communications Commission. I want to read that real quick. It's very short paragraph. It states, it's increasingly clear that the ultra-fast next generation internet networks are the key to building and sustaining thriving communities. They're as essential as good health care, great schools, and reliable public safety. Indeed, in the coming decades, the internet will increasingly become a platform for delivering these and other core services to our citizens, in addition to providing an on-ramp to the jobs and opportunities of tomorrow. So providing high-quality internet is inarguably essential to safeguarding the public interest in the years and decades to come. So this project will be felt, assuming we act on it and complete it, in my guesstimate, for at least 4 decades, that kind of infrastructure will last and will be a source of revenue for our village. So did everyone receive the information I sent? Mm-hmm. Okay, about the reports. I want to go into a little bit about the SWOT results. So we got everybody involved in small groups, and I'm going to get into that. The first page, though, kind of outlines SpringsNet's strategic goals and kind of where we're at with them. We're continuing to analyze our community's need in terms of the fiber and the municipal network. And section 2 and 3 there will go into the graphs, the SWOT results, which I'll talk about in a minute. We're trying to involve strategic stakeholders and relationships with local people. We feel like we have a lot of local expertise that we can draw upon and save in consulting fees and stuff like that. We're trying to develop and evaluate alternatives and do a phased engineering and business plan. So we're kind of in a discovery phase right now. We're developing a blueprint for a proof of concept pilot program that we're going to be working on and hopefully presenting to council in the near future. We're evaluating our performance and how that can be determined, and that's another reason for pushing forward on a pilot project. We think we can get a really good grip on how this could be a very doable thing. And so we're also developing a computer program to capture ongoing community dialogue about how we position our village for sustained success in this program. And that there's going to be more to come about that. So if you look through the results of the SWOT, the first page shows that some of the biggest strengths we have are that we have a Mavetka in the village, and we have an existing electrical infrastructure. Those scored the highest from the feedback panels of the small groups. And some of the biggest weakness was obviously the expense of this project. We know it's not going to be inexpensive, but we think that compared to, we've looked at the numbers from Sandy, Oregon, and we think some of the expenses can be much more affordable than what Sandy had to put out, especially because we already have a data center in town. So, the opportunities, again, economic development was seen as the most outstanding reason for doing this by everybody that participated. Technologically sustainable infrastructure, I think I already spoke to that, is that it lasts a long time. And I think last one is threats. So economic, again, was seen as the biggest threat. Mismanagement worked its way in there, and competition. So you can kind of look these over. Take a look at the video if you get the time. We'll be back in touch with you about our future pilot project. And lastly, there's a couple pie charts here at the end of the document where we kind of pulled exit polls of people that we asked them, should the village be an internet service provider? 77% responded favorably to that idea. And the last graph shows, do you think municipal fiber network should be built? 92% were in favor of that idea. So that's about all I have right now. But if there's any questions, I'm happy to try to answer them.
Thanks, Tim. I want to thank you. It was an excellent forum. I had to leave. Well, I got through all the sessions, but then I didn't get to stay. But it was an excellent event, and I appreciate you all putting it together.
Well, you'll be hearing some more from us in the future.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, Tim. Moving on to old business, would anyone entertain delaying or rescheduling the draft ordinance for boards and commissions? Thank you.
I was too.
And so policing policy discussion process, Mary Ann. Thank you all.
Brian and I have met with several people, including the village manager and chief of police, Alice Jacobs.
John Burley.
To think about how to frame a discussion for council to talk about policing policy. And as we've been talking, we've also been thinking about this issue, how to do this. And I'll say something and then open it for Brian. I think what we're thinking of is looking at what seemed to come out as the values, we value our values, essential values that the community wants in the police. And look at potential strategies for meeting those values. Some of those strategies are being used. Some of them may not be being used. And look at what it is that we want. So what this is not is a critique of the police department. It's certainly not a witch hunt. It's really looking at what do we value. And for probably most of the ways that the police department is functioning is already in alignment with those values. And at the same time, I think we have to recognize that because of things that are happening on a national level, and I'm thinking of the war on drugs, the so-called militarization of police, and issues around Black Lives Matter, that there are perceptions that impact us. And those perceptions may or may not really even be viable in this community, but nonetheless, they do impact us. And that's another reason why we thought it was important for council to be looking at policy values. So that's what we plan on doing. I think it's going to be the July, the second meeting in July, and also providing council with documents that Chief Hale is going to provide that include like the vision and the principles or whatever documents he would want to provide, the articles that have been in the Yellow Springs paper. And I also want to ask the Yellow Springs to, I want to see the survey that they did. They've done some reports on it. And I have some other questions that I plan on asking the paper to sort of flesh out some of the things that were in the paper. And then the information from the community forums that Brian had included, some information related. So, and this will be an initial discussion. I don't think that this is the end of the discussion, and I imagine that there may be some things that we will have to submit to Patty, and then maybe get some feedback ongoingly.
Yeah, I think that covers it pretty well, but you know, when I reflect back to after we had the October 23rd forum, one of the things that I think we had consensus of council was that we needed to sort of formally review and recognize what those values were, make sure we had a public discussion about it. And so when Marianne suggested that we sort of back up and think more generally, that seems in line with what we talked about last fall. And then, you know, as certain issues like the ACE task force need to be addressed in terms of the budget, hopefully we'll be able to have a more logical framework based on those values to make those decisions.
And if it would be helpful, I think we could put together a proposed agenda.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that would be good. I know that a lot of work has been put into this document, the citizens' comments from the local policing forum, to call it down, but it's still a huge laundry list of things. I'd like some way to define this a little bit more, combine a little bit more, go back and look at those numbers, look at, was there a dot exercise or something that we did?
There was a rec.
So I'd like to see a little bit of it fleshed out a little bit more than just a laundry list.
Yeah, if that's possible,
I think it is. It's possible in that there's a much longer document. I think it's close to 20 pages that had a lot of that detail. Patty also has all the original flip chart sheets. And so I think that's a great idea and something that I think HRC will be able to talk about this Thursday.
Okay, sounds good.
Next is the solid waste RFP that was in our packet.
Can we just, I'd like to flip the next two so that we can get Melissa out of here.
Sure, budget schedule for 2015, sure.
Because that's the last thing I believe Melissa's waiting on, so if we could just do that.
So there should be a proposed budget schedule in everyone's packets, and basically what I did was I just recycled the one from last year and just updated the dates with the meeting, so I didn't change it. So if council was comfortable with the timeline in which we did this last year, we did it as an emergency, and the last reading was on at the second meeting in December, which would have allowed me enough time to be able to file it with the county and get a response back by January 1st in order to upload it into the system and have it ready for the first day of the next year. So,
I mean, I think generally it looks good. It's, you know, I like to keep to the schedule. Because my only question would be, Melissa, I mean, looking, and Patty, looking at what we have looming in 2016, I am expecting that there are going to be changes. I'm expecting that there are going to be some proposed cuts. And what I'm wondering is if this more aggressive type schedule is going to really give us enough time to discuss the issues that the cuts, what we're going to have to really be discussing and get community input.
I share that concern.
Well, and I think in general, Melissa and I and staff had a brief discussion about this today at the staff meeting. And while I'm not going to ask my staff to do across-the-board cuts, we are going to ask them to be, you know, a little conservative, and you know, we're going to really be careful about capital purchases, because quite honestly, everybody should be sitting pretty well right now. I mean, I know there, like, one thing we need is a new meter reader van, but in general, we're just going to be really conservative and very careful with what we think we need. Melissa, maybe give a brief update on the condition right now and how we feel about that. I mean, I feel like we're still not in great shape, but we're doing a little bit better than we were at the beginning of the year.
And I would agree. I think that the 2016 is probably going to be a fairly easy year in terms of the general fund. This will be the last year that the current levy is going to be in play. And what has been done in the past couple of years is the transfers out from the general fund have been like the biggest hit to it, even over most of the departments that the general fund funds. And the streets and the parks departments are two of the big departments that have large transfers that go out. It's usually about $700,000 that comes out of that to fund those two departments. Those funds have been built up over the last 2 years, and those are the operating funds, not the improvement funds. And so I think that we could minimize our transfers a little bit, which would help the general fund a little bit this year. And then with the enterprise funds, we've got some rate increases that are going to help those funds as well. So I think that we're taking some steps necessary to make sure that 2016 is going to be a lot more sustainable than some of the past budgets, but we need to definitely think forward as well, though.
And I do want to also say there have been a couple of different approaches that Melissa and I have discussed. You know, one thing that council has briefly mentioned is perhaps an additional levy for streets specifically or something like that. One thing that Melissa and I have talked about are perhaps some changes to the income tax ordinance that has to do with the forgiveness part of it. And so Melissa will be bringing figures before council that shows some of the different revenue increases that can be realized from those different sources. So that will be something that we will have to discuss, so that council can see the different impacts that the various options may have.
So that is another agenda item that we need to work in to future agenda items is working up to the discussing the levy and getting ready, deciding what we're going to do with that in 2016 to get that on the May ballot. Right. So that was one of the commitments we made. So
and I would like to suggest to council that if there is anything specific that you want to see in the budget, if there's a specific report that you want to see a specific fund and how we're spending it. You want to see the figures on the, you know, forgiveness, doing changes to the forgiveness on the income tax.
See, I don't want to mix that in with the budget.
Okay, you want that.
I think the levy and proposals to increase revenue, whether it be with a levy or whether it be through other methods, I think that should be a separate discussion from this particular budget discussion.
Okay. Well,
because we've got two issues. We've got a levy renewal, and then we have, are we going to need additional revenues?
I guess what I would like, and definitely before October, is a suggested overall budget cut, and a rationale for that. In other words, if staff feels like we really don't need to cut the budget, then I'd like a rationale for that. And if staff does feel that there needs to be, I mean, to me, I'm thinking we need to start having major budget cuts unless we can be pretty assured that we're going to be having increased income. And then, if that is the case, I understand that's an if, then I think council, then there's a policy issue of, are we going to be strategic in what we cut and work the staff on that, or are we just going to like...
Well, and I will say, I mean, if you remember last year, the first thing I did when I came in was ask the staff to cut 3% across the board, and everybody cut at least 3%. Most people cut more than 3%, and in doing that, they cut it to where they felt comfortable on the operating budget being able to sustain where it was. And so that's, the staff has had discussions this year about another across the board cut, as what you're talking about. And staff would rather try to look at specific areas as opposed to an across the board cut, because there are some areas that staff feels they just can't cut anymore without really harming operations.
In my view, related to the budget and also related to the levy, I think it's possible that we should be considering, and I don't want to get into a big discussion about it tonight, that we should be considering another, some kind of citizen, a scientific citizen survey. I think maybe it's time. I don't think that having a budget, having meetings open are not getting, eliciting a lot of information, real information from our citizens. We're getting special interest groups coming and telling us what they want or they don't want. I would, maybe it's time we did, it was done 10 or 12 years ago before the first levy went, 2 years I think before we had the levy, a survey about what services citizens are interested in. Maybe it's time for us to start thinking about doing one of those again.
Yes, and I think we need to start, whatever we do, we need to start doing it soon enough so that we don't get into these dates and then after.
I would like to add that the tax budget is going to be July 7th, and I think that should probably be taken as a more serious first look at the budget. What the tax budget is used for is to lobby that we are in need of the property tax dollars that are collected on our behalf by the county. And it also serves as our first estimated resources for the first of the year. I normally file at the end, at December 31st, where our end of year fund balances are and what we look to, or what we hope to bring in for the year. And the tax budget serves as that first document of estimated resources. So I think that if I kind of treat the tax budget a little bit differently in that it will be our first look at where our revenues and our expenditures are going to be, and I kind of break that down in a more clear visual way than what the normal tax budget is presented. I think that that'll at least open the door for discussion a little bit earlier, and that might allow council to be able to make a decision based on that information whether or not they want to push the schedule back. So this is just a suggestion, but once I submit everything July 7th and we talk about the tax budget, that'll be our first look at where we're at, and I'm going to have all of the supervisors add their input to that. Normally it's the finance director and the village manager that kind of do that, and then you get the supervisors on board a little bit later, but we're going to start getting them on board earlier so that that'll be everyone's first look. And based on the tax budget and looking at it a little bit differently, if we want to change the schedule and start to push it up any more, then we could do that at that point.
I'm thinking I'm moving ahead a little bit to future agenda items, but possibly that meeting, it's the 17th of August, maybe we, at this point, the only thing we have on the agenda is the budget, the tax budget. Maybe we can make that a finance meeting so we can talk a little bit about the levy. We can talk about other options for revenues, maybe do a little primer on taxes, you know, review our revenue.
Did you say August?
July
17th.
July.
Oh.
She was talking about July 7th.
No. Well, it says here.
July 7th.
What's the 2016 budget presentation? 8/17 regular meeting.
That should have been October 5th. That was the first date on my schedule.
Is that?
I'm not sure what that came from.
Is that the budget the quarterly budget presentation, or is that? It shouldn't be that month, right?
But related to August,
you know, I was definitely thinking we should consider a work session.
We can't have a work session in August because we only have one meeting.
Oh, shoot.
Yeah.
Oh, it's the,
yeah.
We don't have the first one.
But it could still be a finance meeting. I mean, if you choose to.
Are you saying the August or the?
The August 17th could still be a finance meeting. I mean, we can still have the information as to where we stand at that point, the primer on how the budget works and what you were just talking
or
about.
Or we could split the meetings like we did last month. So, I mean, because I imagine a work session, you know, I'm thinking about honing in on some of the staff feedback that you're getting for July, community feedback. If we are going to launch a survey, that would be the time to start thinking about how that's going to look. So
I'd say let's just keep it as a regular meeting, and but maybe focus on budget, focus on financial things. I don't like going back and forth. Since we only have one meeting, I don't like going back and forth in that situation between a regular meeting and or a special meeting and a work session. But we can, so, okay, we can talk about that during a little bit more during agenda planning. Thanks, Melissa. Solid waste RFP.
Okay, just real quickly, the draft is in there. This is a product of collaboration between myself, Tom Dietrich from the Environmental Commission, Tom Clevenger, and Dana Stortz from Greene County Solid Waste District. There are two things that I want to specifically point out. First of all, there is a section about street fair, and I want to let you know that I'm going to be revising that, and here's the reason why. The village does not pay any of the street fair collection costs. Those are paid entirely by the chamber, and I think this was kind of a holdover from previous contracts. When I spoke to Jason today, he said that it was kind of there as a placeholder so that essentially that whoever the solid waste company was didn't forget that we had these events. And so he and I both agreed that there should be a reminder in there that we have the two street fairs as well as the 4th of July festival, which is, or 4th of July fireworks, and that's a pretty big deal. So I'm going to revise that section, not to say street fair, but to say special events, and to note that we do have three special events, one in June, one in July, and one in October, and that
while some of the costs may be paid from the village for some of the events, that they may also be paid by an event sponsor. And that it's just meant to make them aware that the events occur.
What about New Year's Eve? Is that not
It's New Year's Eve, so that's
yeah, I think it probably should be a little way ambiguous.
Like, yeah, so it will be a, like a special events section. And just as a placeholder, not mentioning anything in particular about the special, you know, this event or that event. Because, as I said, we don't necessarily pay, the village doesn't necessarily pay the fees for any of those. And the other question I had was the thing I highlighted in red about the refrigerator magnet, which kind of seemed a little extraneous to me, but I think it's probably to remind people not only of the number for whoever the waste hauler is, but also it probably has something about recycling or something on it.
That's a very nice suggestion.
So
I don't think it's a bad idea.
I think it's a good idea.
Just to leave it in there?
Yeah.
Okay. So,
I have one other question.
Okay.
Maybe two. So on page 5, public facilities and the sidewalk receptacles, it says service 3 times a week between Monday and Friday. I guess I would like to be sure that Friday is always a pickup day, if possible.
Okay. And that's section C, 2C?
D. 2D, it's actually.
Oh, 2D, okay.
Section 2,
okay.
2 public facilities and then.
And so IMD. Always on Friday.
Yeah, I mean, at least
one must always be on Friday.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, and to that question, in a lot of places in the RFP, I noticed that it talks about current practice, but I didn't see anything about that we're currently doing Monday, Wednesday, Friday in this RFP. So I didn't know if that needed to be included as well to give background, or if it was purposeful that it wasn't.
I think there is a section that says the current schedule somewhere. I've gone through this thing so many different times now. I think it says that they have to maintain the current schedule.
Okay, I just didn't see Monday, Wednesday, Friday mentioned. So.
Right, well, yeah, well, because the current schedule could be something else.
Right, but then.
And so if we leave it generic, they just have to say, what's your current schedule?
Okay, so we don't need to include that it's 3 days a week?
No, it would just have to be whatever our current schedule would be at that time, yeah.
Are the receptacles, I'm back on. On page 5, section 2C. The 20 receptacles, do those include the ones along the bike path?
Those are actually the Green County Parks.
Oh, okay. Those can fill, and they don't get emptied very often at all. The one across from the riding center in particular is overflowing.
Yeah, those are Green County Parks, unfortunately. I mean, I can call them and ask them to empty them, but.
I'm a little surprised about that, but maybe we want to make sure, we want to make absolutely positive that that's the case.
So I had a couple other questions.
Okay.
So in that, I like that final paragraph, M, you know, sort of the additional considerations.
Mm-hmm.
And I wondered why we didn't mention the possibility of less trips. Now I know that we said that might not lead to any savings, but if we're kind of adding different things that they might consider.
You're talking about in the miscellaneous section?
Yeah.
What it says additional information and options.
It says it could include but are not limited to.
Right. So, I mean, because I know that was one of the things that when you presented this before, we threw that out there and said maybe it wouldn't be possible, but.
Well, because I think primarily because we didn't want to change the pickup days. So the way that we were going to reduce the number of truck trips was to have them come in on one day instead of 3 days. And then we wouldn't have them picking up the trash on the street, Xenia and Dayton and the parks for 3 days a week. That was my recollection of it.
I didn't remember us coming to a conclusion,
okay.
But if it
I mean, I can add it in there, but I think that in order to reduce the number of truck trips, we would actually have to change the pickup schedule. I mean, and I'm fine with that, but I just didn't think council wanted to.
I also wonder, it looks to me like we're limiting it to three tiers, but there was a lot of discussion from you and, I mean, in the way that they fill it out, there was a lot of discussion about sort of these ideas of, you know, could we, you know, have smaller container sizes or things like that. And I'm wondering if there's room to look at those or if there was a reason why we stuck with the three tiers.
Well, because the more tiers that you have, this one was actually pared down the last time it went out from being an enormous number of tiers, and that just makes it really difficult for the bidder as well as for us to evaluate the bids. You put the more tiers that you put in there.
Okay.
And so I think that when it was done the last time, it's my understanding from talking to Dan Stortz that it was pared down dramatically because it had so many, and Lori's nodding her head, so yeah.
Okay. Why do we need to have one bulk item per week?
We don't necessarily need to, but I think they make an allowance. Most of the haulers make an allowance for a certain number of bulk items a week. They don't expect everybody to have a bulk item out every week, but it does give you the option of putting it out if you want.
Okay.
And I don't think they include an over number in the bid. I think they expect to have a certain number of them throughout the contract period. But I mean, if council thinks that's excessive, we can.
I just wonder if any of these things impact the pricing, you know, because a lot of them seem like they're fairly like a fixed structure that I'm just not sure is reflecting some of the things that both you and Tom wrote about. So I don't know.
But there's a point at which, you know, I see enough big items sitting out every week in front of people's houses that if we don't have that included,
we got a mess.
And you know, is somebody going to be billed? I guess that would be the thing. If somebody puts out a bulk item, then they're going to be billed separately. You know, that would be.
I guess it all does tie to this issue of, are we trying to encourage, you know, less waste, diversion, and some of those things. So I didn't see some of those things reflected, and I wondered if there's a way to, I appreciate that we need to keep it tight so that it's, you know, not too confusing, but I just wonder if there's a way to adjust some of those things.
And the smallest garbage can you can get is about 35 gallons. I don't know that you can get one much smaller than that. So
the only change in terms of bulk items, I guess, it would be either people would have to get a sticker.
Well,
because you can't, I don't think you can say like one a month because you can be able to keep track.
Right, yeah. Yeah, and I think probably that may be one of the reasons they put one a week was so that way that they know that if somebody's got two out, okay, they need one. But I mean, it would be difficult to keep track of who's putting out the items. And you do have to call ahead for it.
I agree. I understand what you're saying, Brian, and I felt that way until I got to M and saw that basically she was asking for recommendations and suggestions. I think that I don't know that we have the capacity yet to handle some of this stuff unless, I mean, it's going to have to be through the waste haul. I mean, what we don't have compost. I mean, we just don't have a lot of facilities here, so it feels like it's got to be through the trash hauler. And if hopefully somebody's going to present us with some alternatives that we can consider that are more effective and more sustainable.
I appreciate you bringing this up.
Well, I mean, they just really reflect what we have in our packet.
I mean, really, I think it would be good if we did our own, right?
It's a fairly expensive proposition to do.
I know, and then we'd have to have some place to do it. But it means that then we have to really deal with our stuff.
Well, I realize our options are limited. I just, hopefully, I'm not really sure that this RFP is going to change the status quo. So I just want to put that out there.
Well, I mean, and maybe that can be beefed up. Maybe it can be something like, you know, attention or favorable attention will be given to alternative proposals.
Well, did Tom
to create alternative proposals?
Yes.
And they've
In fact, all of their suggestions are incorporated.
I feel pretty confident that Tom. They both are very. They work in this. Their Tom worked in this field for many years. Tom Clevenger did. So I'm confident that if he looked at this and said, "This is a good stab at what we want," then given the parameters of Ohio trash collection, you're right. We did it ourselves. We would have to deal with it, but it's a very expensive thing to start.
Okay, so I have, for the changes I have for 2D, to make sure that at least one of the pickups is always on Friday for the trash cans. To make a mention that they do have to maintain the current schedule, make sure that that's in there. And then the assignment to myself to make sure the bike trail cans are emptied. And then, Brian, I will look at that section on the large item pickup, but there are generally quite a few large items out throughout the village. And I think part of the problem is that we pick up different areas on different days. So, you know, it may be that I'm seeing large items, you know, constantly because we pick up different areas on different days. But maybe I'll send out an email to Tom and Dana to see if they have a suggestion on that.
Okay.
No, I'll incorporate these and bring them back to council at the next meeting for passage to get it out.
Thank you. Okay, now we're moving on to manager's report.
Okay, let me get down to that. All right. The week completion, they should be in town. Gene Pyle should be in town for a couple more weeks. And as noted during the break, they will be charging the line on Livermore Street tomorrow, June 2nd, and then flushing that same line on June the 3rd. So if you live in the area of that new line on Livermore Street, you may have some brown water. So please be prepared for that. The streetscape bid has been issued and we will be opening the bids on June the 8th, and I hope to have a recommendation council at the June 15th meeting. We did have a meeting with the business owners and talked to them, and we all agreed that an approximate start date of July the 20th would be a good start time for everybody. Probably work out, so that is what we are shooting for. The installation of the new library roof should be beginning. They were hauling materials up to the top of the building last week so that they would have all their items up on top, and they should be beginning the actual installation soon. Jason will be working with them closely to ensure the installation of the new drywall. I know that is an issue for a lot of people because of the drainage. The pool is open at Gaunt Park and ready for use, and the softball leagues are underway on Tuesdays and Thursdays, so go down there and watch people having some fun. I have been asked to serve on the Yellow Springs Senior Center Support Services Advisory Committee, and I have accepted, and we're having our first meeting on Wednesday, so I will be serving on that. The HyperReach system, we did mention that earlier. It is a system by which we put out a blanket phone call to those folks who are signed up to let them know about weather alerts or boil advisories or something like that. So if you are not signed up for the HyperReach system and would like to, as Marianne noted earlier, you can do that from our website. If you do not, for some reason, have a computer or access to a computer, you can call the police department and they will help you out with that. I do have two additional items
that were not on my report that came up today. Beginning with the disconnections in June, we will no longer offer the reinstatement of service after regular business hours. While the ordinance provides for reconnection of service the next business day, that's all the ordinance says, the village has routinely provided a call-out service after hours for a small additional amount. However, this amount does not cover the cost of calling in an employee to reinstate the service. It's $15 additional, and it does not even come close to covering our call-out for our employees. So, instituting an amount that was sufficient to cover the call-out would probably make it prohibitive for most people, and so we are going to revert back to what the ordinance actually says, and the reinstatement, if you're disconnected, the reinstatement of service will occur between 8 a.m. and 4 p.m. Monday through Friday. We will be putting this in several different places, including the delinquency notices and the disconnection notices, and everyone should know that we do not shut people off on Friday. So they will not be, have the opportunity to get their service back on before the weekend. So if we shut you off on Thursday, you have the opportunity, you can come down and pay your bill at the police department as normal, but we will not come out and reinstate your service until Friday during the day when the staff is here. Are there any questions about that? Okay. And the last thing that I have is that this morning I did receive a letter of resignation from Joe Bates. Joe has been offered a position with the Xenia Water Department as the superintendent, the water plant supervisor, I think is his technical title. And so Joe will be leaving us. His last official day is June 12th, but he did ask me if he could take some vacation next week. And so this Friday at 2 p.m., we will be having a get-together in A&B for Joe, if you would like to come down and wish him well.
Is there a hiring plan?
Yeah, Ruth Ann and I were working on that today. I will be talking to some of the current departmental employees to see if they want to act as interim. And then we will hire, you know, begin the hiring process. It will be advertised within as well as without. Joe suggested a couple of different websites that he thought that we should advertise on. And we'll go from there.
It's very sad news. He's been a great, yeah, that's why he won many awards.
Yeah.
It's a real loss to our village.
Yeah.
But obviously we wish him all the best.
Yeah, he said that.
He's luckily just down the road, so we can maybe call him occasionally.
Well, he already offered that. He did already offer that, and you know, he said, you know, I just can't pass it up. It's not only is it more money, but it's better hours, and I don't have to work weekends. So
wow. Nice.
Yeah. So,
Patty, I also just, since we got this on our table, wanted to say I really liked the highlights from the police department.
Yes, and I'm sorry I did not mention that, Chief. I apologize. Chief Hale did submit this afternoon to me a highlighted bullet point report on some of the activities of the police department and what he and his officers have been up to. And I think it's pretty interesting reading. I mean, Officer Meister did a bike ride with some of the kids. Chief actually, I think, spoke at the graduation.
Breakfast.
Oh, at the breakfast.
Yes,
okay.
The breakfast.
At the senior breakfast at the high school, you know, it explains how many business checks they did and what other types of complaints they handled. Chief Hale attended the Antioch Circus, just a lot of different things. And
Antioch School.
Antioch School.
Right. And also,
it is late, and I've been here since 8 o'clock, so I apologize.
But also, there's a lot of stuff that's not on here. Like, I've been seeing the officers at Mills Lawn in the morning and afternoon, and that's been really great. Thanks.
John, do you have a report?
My report is not in the packet because I was out on vacation last week. I did travel up the West Coast and explored 10 miles of Los Angeles sidewalk. Which was all in poor condition around the tree. So I did not pass my evaluation walking. The other thing is I also was in Santa Barbara, and I got to see Antioch University out there, which is totally nice. But as far as what's going on my end of things, we're going to have a planning commission meeting next Monday to hear once again the proposed vacation of the East Sherman Street right-of-way for Antioch College. And then we'll also have a Board of Zoning Appeals hearing for two cases, one involving a fence height variance for 120 Railroad Streets, and then another one involving an interior lot line setback for at least 302 Cord, but the corner of Glen and Corey Street. So that will be both Monday and Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Okay. And then we also have the fellows. I wasn't here for the last week, but I heard they had this amazing report, and I hope to view it on YouTube when it's up.
Great. Judy?
I have a question for Joan. You're going to be doing some research on our existing sidewalks. So a sidewalk, so what is the next step that you're going to do?
You guys have assigned me some things to follow up on. I'm still gathering that information, and I was going to present it back at the next meeting in June. So some of the questions that you guys had asked the last meeting.
Where I'm leading is when we're looking at, when we're evaluating sidewalks, I think it would be helpful to also have a sense of what kind of streets in Yellow Springs could be complete streets. You know, that term that's being used. There's another multi-use streets. Multi-use streets. So for example, Livermore Street that could serve, and I mean functionally does serve, for pedestrians, wheelchairs, bicycles, and cars.
And
so if we had a sense of what streets are serving that, could potentially serve that, and what kind of things that could be put there, whether it's lines or whatever, to help with that. And then also, what streets or where really sidewalks might most be needed. I mean, like I was driving down Fairfield, and I don't even know how you could put it there.
Yeah. Well, but that's where the safe routes to school sidewalk is going.
Yeah.
That kind of information for when we're looking at.
And that's something I consider, but it's a broader policy.
Yeah, that's huge. Sidewalks. Yeah, that's huge. We can talk about it at the next meeting.
Yeah.
At the work session. Judy?
I would just say the Village Run website is coming along, and we have additional trainings coming up that'll get us further along towards that goal, and it's looking like potentially mid to late July for going live with it. That's it.
Okay. So future agenda items. So we just identified that the topic for June 15th is sidewalks. So John will come armed with information for that. Mm-hmm.
And we're just doing a work session.
Yeah, at this point, unless there is some emergency ordinance, I don't anticipate anything else. We will have, and Lori and I kind of started the evaluation, kind of looking at the evaluation for Patty, so we will have that fleshed out for the July meeting. Tax budget, Melissa just said, will be on the 6th. Biannual goals review, and then hopefully we'll get Planning Commission's recommendation. So that's three pieces of three items. Work session, July 20th on policing, no meeting August 3rd. Then, as we talked about, we'll do more finance, kind of have a finance meeting on August 17th, at the only meeting in August. And we did add that would include more specifics on the budget, some revenue alternatives and levy, talking about the levy timeline. And then we have the draft ordinance for boards and commissions back on the table
do we want to try to fit that into the July 6th?
We may need, I know it may seem to kind of defeat the purpose, but there are 5 weeks in August, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. So we, if it's really feeling jammed, the purpose of freeing up that first meeting was partly so that Judy could actually plan to be gone and have a vacation time that's built in. But so we could, if things are really starting to feel like we can't do it all and there's more that we need to do, I would think August wouldn't be a bad month to have a
third meeting.
A third meeting that's really the
second. Well, a second meeting now. So do we want to schedule that now or just leave it maybe for the next meeting to?
I think let's leave it.
Yeah, and see what.
And we could sort of also start looking at the calendars because I think there's 4, so we could potentially do it for 5.
There is.
There's 5 Mondays,
yes,
so we can choose between the two Mondays.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
I have a quick question.
Oh, excuse me.
When is the next round of charter review discussion going to be done?
Oh, that's a good question.
Because I didn't.
Yes, oh my God, we did forget that. We did just.
Yeah, I would assume that we would do it on the 15th because we've got that August 5th, and if we're not.
Yes, okay, so that'll have to be part, and that can be part of the work session.
Yeah.
Because
yes.
So the whole mayor. Now, I think we are going to have to get much more clarification. Given what's already, it seems, has happened in the community, just the little bit that's been out. So we're going to have to get a little bit better clarification.
Do you want that in writing? I mean, I'm prepared to make a presentation.
Yeah, that would be good, but I think maybe it would be good for it to be in writing.
Well, I mean, do you want something else that's other than what's in the report?
I think the rationalization
because that seems to be that's what Dan was asking
for our recommendations.
No,
well,
for why
it's why
it's
even in there. Why
right.
We asked you to do it and what the sort of history of that was. Because honestly, I'm a little fuzzy.
Yeah, well, we didn't do it.
No,
so
the council asked you to look at
it. Yeah,
so that's what we're trying to.
I can address that in the presentation that I give.
That would be good. Okay.
That's what we're doing on the 15th.
That would be June 15th, yes. And I think what we should do is have, that'll be the first, the sidewalks will be the first discussion, the charter review will be the second discussion. That meeting. Motion to adjourn. Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye.